Hi, everyone.
Hello. Happy Tuesday.
Welcome to Simply Seasonal Live.
Yeah. There we are. We're back, I think. Hi. Well, welcome. Thank you for joining us, everyone. We have had a few questions about bone broth, so we're going to go over that today because that was our episode that went live last week. So we've gotten a few good ones. And then we'll kind of just talk about some other things that we weren't really able to mention in the episode. That's kind of like what these Q&As are kind of about, is us to expand upon what we couldn't really cover in just 5 minutes. So if you have any questions too, feel free to type them in on Instagram or Facebook and we'll get to them. So we wanted to start with our first question, which is from Rachel, and she asks, why does my bone broth turn gelatinous sometimes?
And not others.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big key thing.
Yeah. So we get this all the time. And one of the biggest things just to know about that gelatinous property that you'll see, especially if it sits in the refrigerator for a little bit and you pull it out and it's like literally all jello, that is that collagen that we're talking about. That's the stuff that people are spending a lot of money on buying, and it's right there. So
that's what we're trying to get out of the bones.
That's pulling straight from the bones.
It's not a bad thing. Yeah.
Yeah, so it is gelatinous. It is jello. It's where jello comes from. Jello's not vegan because it comes from bones.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I know like my grandmother was big into jello, and she'd always kind of infer that it was good for you.
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
And that always kind of confused me. And I think, I mean, that's where it all comes from. And I know that later in her life, she... she had like a medicine for her arthritis that she would mix into water. Do you know what that's called? And I mean, it pretty much was like gelatin.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like drinking gelatin.
Because when you think about it, it's that like kind of, I mean,
okay, gooey.
So gelatinous, it's gooey. It's kind of slimy. It's kind of looks like a lubricant, like if you're working on a machine or something like that and you put kind of like a lubricant to like with all the like working parts, it's going to help with that, like a Vaseline or something, which is like
WD-40.
Good, but yeah, and so it's going to do the same thing for your joints. So that's what she was doing, is using that for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's what's really happening, is that gelatinous property is being pulled from the bones. That's the collagen. That's the stuff that we're talking about that we really want to be eating. And depending on how long you cook it will make it more gelatinous than others. So if you just cook some bone stock for, you know, an hour or so, you're probably not going to get that. That's like we were talking about, kind of the difference between a stock or broth versus a bone broth. Is that the shorter period of time isn't going to be able to take as much of the nutrients from the bone as cooking them for 24 or 48 hours, and that's really getting everything out of there. So you're more likely to end up with a gelatinous broth when it's been cooked for a long period of time.
And so one other thing is that sometimes I'll have my carcass, if I had cut my chicken up, say, and then I'm making the bone broth from it, maybe we didn't eat the wing, like I'll just use the wings and throw them right into the pot, and the skin is still on it and everything, and the skin kind of gives off a little bit more fat and stuff at the end, you know, more goopy stuff at the end. So that might be another answer to the question, is that maybe there's other things like skin and fat that you included in this batch, and that might make it more gelatinous.
Or even sometimes a little foggier, and it's not a bad thing. But sometimes, like when I am, say I roasted a chicken, and then we like eat some of the chicken and not the rest, I take off the rest of the meat, and with the bones, I really just try to kind of clean them off as best as I can. I don't get like too crazy about it, but pull as much off as I can so that when the bones are cooking, you know, it's just really the bones, because the meat kind of has been cooked and you're trying to eat the meat separately. So, and then another question that we've gotten is, why do some recipes call for adding a vinegar or an acid into a bone broth and others don't? So that's a really good question too. And when I first learned how to make a bone broth, we were adding in an acid, because what acid does is it helps break the bones down. But
so the idea is you're pulling stuff out of the bones faster and easier than without it.
So we would do that even in my natural culinary school, and it's not a bad thing, but when you're cooking a bone broth for like 12 or 24 or 48 hours, that's really the power is in the time, because it takes time to pull the nutrients out of the bones. So even though vinegar is going to help break the bones down a bit more so that you can pull out, it's kind of adding a quicker implement into the recipe when the goal of the recipe is for duration of time. It's this slow process that it's taking nutrients deep from the bones, so you might not need to try to expedite it by putting vinegar in it, if that makes sense. I've also heard a teacher who I study under, Andrea Beeman, she always says, well, if you are putting the vinegar in and it's pulling and breaking apart the bones in the broth, then when you're drinking it, that might be doing the same thing to you too. And that's kind of defeating the purpose, which then gets into the whole thing, like, is vinegar and acid bad for you? No, but anyway, we won't even go there.
And that's the hard part about all these nutritious things, is that you hear one thing and then you hear conflicting information from one philosophy to the other. And so it's really about just feeling what's right for you, don't you think?
Absolutely. Yeah. So if you want, and you always have, or your grandmother always used to put apple cider vinegar or something like that in her bone broth, go for it if you'd like. But we don't have that in our recipe, just because we say that we're going to be cooking it for 12, 24, 48 hours, however big your and thick your bones are. So when you do the duration, that's kind of the best way to get all the nutrients from it.
Hey, Kat.
Hey, Kat. Yeah, and then so I guess something that we also touched on a little bit before was the energetics of different bone broths and different animals. So, of course,
we love this topic,
because you could have, you know, a cow, you could have, you know, so like some beef bones, you could have some chicken bones, or you could just have a veggie stock. And all of those are fantastic, and they're good for different reasons because they have different energy.
Yeah. And so, like, what are you feeling now in your life in this season, in this time? How, you know, how's your health? And just kind of gauging where you are there and deciding what kind of broth would be appropriate. I mean, certainly as we go into warmer seasons and we're working with broth, you know, a nice veggie broth in the springtime is going to help really clear you up, especially if you tend to get very mucousy and, you know, so if you're still doing broths at that time, you know, we can even kind of move out of the hot, the warmer foods. It is good to just recognize where you are in your health and your body condition, and knowing what kind of energy you need. Yeah.
Right. So, so for a lot of people, during the winter, it's a good time to do maybe more of your beef stocks or something that's heavier, because that's going to help ground you. So, you know, and think about how big and heavy a cow is, right? Like, they're really big. So that grounding, warm energy is really going to be there. Then a chicken, like we've said before, they're a little bit more flighty, so that's going to give you more of that type of energy. So if you're feeling down in the dumps or you're feeling really lethargic and heavy, then maybe a chicken broth is a better option, because that's going to bring more of that energy. But vice versa, if you feel really flighty and like you're all over the place, maybe you want the beef to help ground you.
And that might be even a whole lifetime answer for you. You know, if you don't move in, right, this energy doesn't move for you in the year or the season or whatever, if just in general as a person you're always flighty and anxious and moving around, like, bone broth is really a nice grounding thing for you.
It's a very grounding thing.
Well, and beef bone broth is what I meant.
And then the vegetable bone broth, like Kara was saying, you know, during the warmer months or even during this season of winter, if you are someone who is maybe more like mucousy or feeling again like lethargic or maybe even have like a heart condition or something like that, mm-hmm. then maybe getting that veggie broth through you, that's going to be a little bit more cleansing. And remember, the veggie broth is usually already made with roots so that there is a grounding component mm-hmm. to it. That's still
a good
point. Yeah. The onions, the carrots, the garlic, mm-hmm. all of those are still grounding. It's just going to be energetically a little bit more different cleansing. Energy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if you are that person who's heavy and feel heavy and sludgy all year round, it's like your constant fight, then saying to the lighter broths is,
yeah.
is your game. That's your game plan.
mm-hmm. Yep. And so that's just kind of, I guess, when we were talking about this too, we're kind of talking a lot about homemade, making it ourselves. Right. Mm-hmm. So
forgot about that topic. Yeah, that was so like the thing I wanted to talk about.
This
the
is
most.
Like her topic. The difference between, yeah. you know, making it at home versus buying it.
Yeah.
In the store.
So there was one day and I was even at Central Market that day and I'm texting Megan. I'm going, look at this. You know, so you look at all these stocks on the shelf and mm-hmm. I promise even the healthiest, most organic looking ones, read the ingredients because there's so many flavor enhancers in there that it's not something you're gonna be doing at home and it's not something, you know, your body really needs because now, again, you're taking away from that authentic, just understanding the flavor and the taste and the energy of the food. It's being messed with. And then there was one that was like organic beef broth, right? And the first ingredient was like powdered beef concentrate, right? Isn't
yeah.
that what it was? Something mm-hmm. like that. And so, I mean, basically, and it's just going, what? So, yeah. I mean, it's a processed food, right? And the whole purpose of this is to just get off of that. And not only that, so there's all these ingredients that we don't need in there. A lot of them will add food coloring. Caramel food coloring mm-hmm. is like the worst. It's actually banned in Europe and our FDA has not banned it yet. Mm-hmm. I'm sure they will.
We hope.
You know, there's a lot, and I mean, any food coloring, we just like, why? We don't need it. You know, I know there's a lot of parents who take their kids just off food coloring and their behavior changes completely, which
wow.
is so
yeah.
fascinating.
It's a chemical compound.
Yeah.
That's messing
and it's
body.
Like allergic, right. And these kids yeah. don't know how to settle themselves
right.
down. And, you know, I've heard really interesting stories about that. And
then the yeast.
So there's that. Oh, and then there's the yeast extract, which we were just doing a little research on it. Cause it's, you know, sometimes I go a little overboard. I'm like, what's that? You know, and it is kind of similar to an MSG compound. So, you know, when I hear MSG, I'm like, no, my body doesn't react well to MSG. I know that. And a lot of people are having that feeling and that reaction. So now that's the new buzzword that no MSG. So now a lot of products are getting around that by finding alternatives that are similar to MSG that do the same thing, but they don't have to call it MSG and they can say no MSG.
They can say
but they do
yeast
have
extract,
yeast extract.
But they don't
and people
say
look at that
MSG.
And go like, oh, what's so bad about yeast? You know, like,
yeah.
well, actually there is some, you know,
especially when it's corn derivative, you know, mm-hmm. like you can have great yeast is really good. We have yeast in our gut that's really important. Of course, when we have overgrowth, that's when there becomes an issue. Mm-hmm. But yeast is a good thing, but it's where is it coming from? And most of the time it's coming from a byproduct of corn because we have so much corn in our country. It's government subsidized. Then they go, what do we do with this extra? We can turn it into high fructose corn syrup. We can turn it into MSG and yeast extract. And I mean, you just look up the list. They are pages long of all the names.
I found that list finally. It printed on my printer.
Oh,
oh my gosh. Can I go get, will you
yeah,
talk for a minute? I'm going to
go
grab it.
Yeah, I was going to answer
this is
Rachel's
so
question.
Fun. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
Oh my gosh. Okay, we're squished
yeah,
in there. Sorry.
Squished. Our bar stools. So Rachel asked a really good question. I'll read it. So, and I know she has a little one on her lap too. So she said there was a typo. But I have some split beef marrow bones. No advantage to random baby sent that. Question is, any advantage leaving the bone marrow in the bone for broth? No, right? So if you got the split bone marrow bones to make bone marrow in the oven, you absolutely could if you wanted to roast them. And then, you know, usually you have that bone marrow laid out there with a spoon and you can have like a nice baguette with some garlic bread and oh my gosh, like that's so good. Yeah. So you could do that if that's why you bought the bones in the first place, was to make bone marrow for like dinner or an appetizer or something like that. And then once you eat the marrow out of the bones, you still, that's perfect to use those bones in a bone broth because now they've been roasted, and roasting really and cooking in any way allows actually nutrients to come out of the bones much easier than raw. So, but if you were to use those same, yes, that's the plan. Okay, cool. Yeah. So make your delicious bone marrow, or Jay in the kitchen when he's cooking, make your delicious bone marrow, dinner that you're going to have, and then use those bones in the broth afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I have returned from the printer. This right here, it's 2 pages. Wait, how do I get it in there?
There you go.
Okay. It's 2 pages long. These are all the derivatives of corn.
Yeah, that are on the ingredients list all the time. And you're like, oh, it doesn't say sugar. Yeah. But it says all of these things.
Oh my gosh. I mean, it's everything from artificial flavorings and sweeteners, fruit juice concentrates, fumaric acid. You want to try reading something? Of course, the corn syrups. Lactate, sucrose. Laurel, glucoside, keep popping them out.
Splenda.
Desyl polyglucose.
Sorbic acid.
Saccharin, MSG, sucrose, sweet and low, vanillin. Look, it even says vanilla natural flavoring.
Mm-hmm.
Even vanilla pure or extract. So, I mean, they're just flavoring it, right? And then there's your yeast.
So, and again, the reason they're doing that is to be able to name it different things. So when you glance at the ingredient list, you're not like, oh, there's MSG in there, but they say it in a different form. So you're like, you don't even think about it. So you buy it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a marketing ploy. Hi, Maihan. Good to see you. And then Rachel said, how long should I roast the bones that haven't been roasted already? So, I mean, it just depends. I would, you know, like 400 degrees is a good temperature. Just pop them in the oven and roast them really until you just see them get nice and browned. And, you know, it should probably take like 30 minutes, maybe 40, just depending if it's like, you know, how big the bone is. But once you just get that nice brown caramelized thing looking on the outside, then they're pretty much good to go because they're nice and cooked. So the nutrients are going to come out much easier. And just going back to the bone marrow thing too, I just want to make sure I fully answer it as well, is yes, there's a lot of nutrients in the bone marrow. So most of the times, if your bones aren't split and you aren't eating it in the way that you are, which is splitting it, roasting it, and then eating the bone marrow straight out, that is an element out of all bones that you're pulling out, is the marrow. But even if you already eat the marrow out of the bones, there's still nutrients deep in the bones itself that you're still going to extract in your bone broth. So if that fully answers your question.
It keeps going. And this is why, you know, when I go and buy a nice free-range chicken from the farmer's market and it's $25 and people go, oh my gosh, it's $25. But do you know how many meals I get out of this $25 chicken? And it's this beautiful, hey, Jill. Jill's joining us from Italy.
Oh, hey.
you know, first of all, you can start with a soup or a roast and you have that meal. Usually we're not going to use all of the meat, so we can pull some of that meat. When you are dealing with a free-range bird like this, a really nutrient-dense bird, I know with my son, even when he was a teenager, he'd be able to, we'd get those roaster chickens from the supermarket, and he can like, he'd just like slurp, he can eat an entire chicken by himself as a teenager. And then I started getting these nutrient-dense game bird, like real chickens, and he would have one piece, like a leg and a thigh, and just be like, I'm full. and he didn't even understand why. Yeah. But there's so much more nutrients, so we're eating less of it. It's very cool. Uh-huh. And so then you can take the meat from that and turn it into something else, some great chicken recipe, because we always see like what to do with miscellaneous chicken, right? I'm like, I don't buy pieces of chicken, I buy a whole chicken. So it's hard when you see every recipe, like, just throw your chicken breast in this, chicken breast in that. And I'm like, they're just putting like pieces of rubber in stuff. I don't know. And so anyways, then from there you can make, you know, you can make a soup, you can make your broths, you can do, and then once you have these broths too, mm-hmm. it's like the flavor keeps building because you put those in your freezer, right? And you have them for later. And next time I get another chicken and go to make a chicken soup, I can use the broth from the last chicken, and it's like, it keeps
building. But you add it to your broth?
Well, no, I'll add it, like, if I'm making chicken soup, I'll use the broth from chicken before.
Because you have the bones in there, and then you're adding the
broth. And then you add into that. And so, I mean, oh my gosh. And so the flavor keeps building and building and building. And, like, talk about, like, grandma's, like, that's kind of like the old world
chicken soup.
And just how, like, you know, I know a lot of like grandmas, nanas would have like the pot on the stove that just was continuous, like they just keep, it was like a soup pot that never ended. Like, you just keep adding to it and you just eat out of it whenever you're hungry, and she's always adding stuff in. And I think that's a fascinating
and it's way a very cheap way of eating. It's a very, I mean, that's at the end of the day too, when we're talking about homemade versus store-bought's so expensive because it's gotten so trendy. I love it when food fads get trendy because people are going to be eating it more, and they should. But the downside is that they catch on to it and they go, oh, I could sell this little box. Even Kettle and Fire, which is one that I do recommend if you are going to buy. It's usually a pretty good brand. But they sell it. It's like only this big.
It was $7.99.
$7.99 for two cups
of broth. And that's what we're talking about you making is like 4 quarts. Right.
Yes, and it's literally leftovers. Or even if you buy everything on its own, it's still going to cost you like maybe $10 max for all that stuff. And you're making 4 quarts.
Do you know that, like, in New York City right now, there's, you know, bodegas that sell cups of bone broth, like coffee, like people are drinking it like their coffee.
Yeah, Rachel, have you been to any of those? Rachel lives in Manhattan. Yeah, there are. And for a while too, there were like lines around the side of just people trying to get like a mug or like a little coffee cup of bone broth. So, so I mean, of course you can do that. You can buy it. You can do all that stuff. Just make sure that you're looking and seeing if the ingredients are what you would be making in your kitchen. Rachel said, scene. Yeah, it's a whole scene in New York. Yeah, and today it would be. I mean, it's freezing all throughout the country. Like, I would stand in line for a cup of bone broth right now because I don't have any right this second, and that would be really tasty.
Oh, my gosh. Amazing.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. So, and Jill says she loves hearing about bone broth. I do know that about you, Jill. So
good. Yeah. And that's another thing too. Like, if something like this resonates with you, you know, that's usually indicating that it's something really good for you to incorporate. You know, it's just start listening to your body, your intuition. If you're very curious about a certain food, or you know, you're craving something,
Pay attention to that.
You know, that's something that your body could definitely use. And, you know, we're in the middle of winter. It's a really, really cold day all around the country today. This is a great thing to incorporate, whether you're having it in a mug or you're cooking with it in a soup or a stew, or if you're making a risotto, you can add it to that. Like, just cook with it, you know? So you're getting
Jill,
that
you can
warm.
Make some risotto with your bone broth, some of your famous risotto.
Oh, my God. That sounds so good.
She's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. And then as we start moving towards the spring, you know, we're going to start slowing down on that and incorporating maybe more, like we were saying before, of the lighter broths that might be vegetable-based, because then we're going to move into more of that cleansing. But right now is the time to build and warm and nourish so that you have that energy for the rest of the year. If we cleanse too much right now during the winter, we're going to be depleted by the time we get to summer and wonder why.
And then your body's not going to want to let go of anything. So you're going to be like, why aren't I losing weight? I'm on this, you know, cleanse and I'm not losing weight.
It's because the body doesn't have energy. So now's the time to get this really good energy and nutrition deep into your bones. Because your bone marrow, sorry, this is another tangent, but our bone marrow is where all of our deepest, deepest nutrients are. It's where our immune cells are made. It's where our blood cells are made. So our immune system, everything is made in our bone marrow. And this is also why, so in Chinese medicine, the kidney element, winter is the season for the kidneys, regulates the bones. So if the kidneys are depleted through stress or fatigue or just not being nourished properly, especially during the winter, childbirth, all of that stuff, because it's very, you're giving away so much energy. If they become so depleted, what ends up happening is it'll pull from our bones, because our bones have the deepest level of nutrients in them, mm-hmm. which is our bone marrow. So this is also why we see it more in women than men too. Mm-hmm. Osteoporosis, osteopenia, this depletion of bones. And it's not a calcium issue. You know, this
isn't... I was going to say, do you want to get into that? Because I would... I mean, we want our bones to be flexible and soft. We don't want them to be hard, as a rock. And that's why you hear about, you know, all these old ladies falling and breaking their hips. Because they've been on calcium pills, because they're told to take calcium. And they don't need... The calcium will really harden their bones and solidify them. And then when they fall, yeah, their bone's going to shatter.
Totally. We're envisioning this. It gets clear as day.
We want to be like, when we take the fall, our bones want to be like, ba-boing, ba-boing, ba-boing.
And when you take a cross section, or you can even look at the bones in your bone broth too, you'll see that it's kind of like this little spongy pattern. And like a cross section of a bone is a spongy pattern. And it looks kind of like a little web. It's like a webbing, really, is what it is. And that allows like this cushion effect. Even though bones are hard, they still have this cushion effect. And that's what you're getting through the collagen, the elasticity from the bones and the bone broth that you're bringing in. It's going to give that cushion. And also walking and having a good, you know, it's keeping it compact but nice and bouncy. Versus if we're taking all these supplements, hardening things, it's going to harden it. And then, like Kara was saying, you're going to break or you're going to become brittle. And
brittle
the bones,
is a good word.
The bones are going to start to chip. You might break bones more easily, things like that. So like Kara was saying, that cushiness is very important for healthy bones, which you're not going to get in any supplement form. You're only going to get that through food, specifically seasonal food.
Simply seasonal.
Simply seasonal food.
We got something going here, guys.
Yeah. Okay. So, thank you. We, Rachel, yes, it's a whole scene. That was from the thing. But thank you so much for tuning in. This is awesome. We've had so many of you, I mean, from New York to Italy, all around the country. Thank you so much. And if you ever want to catch up on our lives, if you missed them, just remember that after this, we also post it on the actual blog post page on our website. So for the bone broth, it'll have our episode, the recipe for bone broth, and then our live Q&A at the bottom. So you can always refer back.
Organized.
Very organized for you, because we just want to be a resource for you guys. So thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you next Tuesday at noon Central Time.
And be sure to tell your friends and share us and, you know,
please.
Spread us around.
Please,
spread
please,
the word.
All right. Bye, you guys.
Bye,
thank
everyone.
You. See you
Thanks
later.
Thanks for joining us.
Bye.
Bye.